Aja Kemits Larsen. Hún er barnatalsmaður á Grænlandi. Ný skipu tók til starfa í mars síðastliðin. Hún er þarna, með meistarapróf í opinberri stjórnsýslu og hefur áralanga reynslu að vinna með börnum og ungmennum og einnig með þarna, frjálsum félagasamtökum varandi börn. En hún starfaði í eitt ár hjá Sameinuðu þjóðunum að málefnum sérst, frumbyggja, sérst, réttindamálum frumbyggja. Þannig að gjör svo vel, verð svo gú. Við gleðum oss.
Thank you very much, and thank you to Margaret Maria and to the Barneombuds here in the office here in Iceland, and thank you to my colleagues from the Nordic. It's a very great pleasure for me because it's a very new institution. So as you will see, my presentation will be almost in blank papers because we're this new. But I'm looking forward to showing you some pictures in time of Greenlandic children, because we have some very beautiful children. As Margaret Maria was saying, this new institution, it's called a spokesperson instead of an ombudsman, and the reason is that we want to take more general cases instead of single cases. And the institution was established in March 2012, and I was appointed in April 2012. So it's a institution that's only 2 months old. The secretariat of my office and of the office of the coming National Council is named MIO. And there's a little story to this. It's because before the secretariat was a research and documentation center for children and youth, and it was called MIBI. And I wanted to have a name that was just almost similar, but still signaling something new. So that's the new name of the secretariat. The National Council hasn't been appointed yet, so we're hoping that we can meet in maybe August or in September this year. So as you can see, it's still a very new institution. The UN Children's Rights Commission Convention was ratified in Greenland in 1992, so it's quite a couple of years ago, and it's part of the law for children and youth in Greenland. As you can see and or hear in our presentation, in most countries, it's the difficult thing is not making the law or ratifying the convention, it's getting from the law to the practical thing. There's been a research, I think it's 2 years ago, that was stating that approximately one-third of all children in Greenland are suffering from some kind of not feeling well in general. And there's all kinds of different things. It's from hunger, poverty, sexual abuse, and it's a huge absence in school, resulting in a lot of children going away from school without having their exam. A huge challenge for Greenland is the economic. We have a strong relation to Denmark, and we're very dependent upon the economic contribution from Denmark. It's about 40% of our BNP, and since we decided to be more and more independent, we've gone from hjemmestyre to selvstyre, and the political parties wanting to be even more independent. We need to look for other ways to find our economic background. At the same time, you can say that children and youth are prioritized economically, but when we need to save, like in most countries because of the financial crisis, we need to find more innovative ways to use the same amount of money, or maybe even a lesser amount of money. So we have a huge challenge in this area. There's a report from a commission that has been set out in Greenland called the Tax and the Welfare Commission. And one of the things that they were saying was that status quo is not an option. And then they're, you know, focusing on the economic part. But I would say at the same time, it's not a visual, wistful option, because we know that there are so many children in Greenland who are suffering. So you can say we have a double-sided challenge in this way, both economically, but also changing the society as a whole. When I've said all these maybe tough things about Greenland, you can also say on a positive note that there are so many positive things happening. We have had the same government for 30 years, and we had a system change here 3 years ago. So there's a lot of positive things happening. We got the spokesperson and the Children's Rights Office, and we're waiting for the National Council for Children. We got Børnehuset, which I know you have in Iceland here, and which we're seeing later on today. And there's a huge collaboration about a children and a youth strategy. And even more important, there's some money set off for it. So we're actually able to do something. So these are very positive trends in Greenland. At the same time, we have some strong NGOs, and they're growing bigger and bigger and getting more and more money from funds. And they're quite good at collaborating together. So it's we have a lot of good things going for us in Greenland. There are some conditions that I think might be very important for you to know. We're the world's biggest island, so we are on a it's a very huge geographic area that we're covering. At the same time, we're only 56,000 people in the whole of Greenland. As in Iceland, we only live around the coast because there's ice in the middle. The geographic challenge for us is that we're 18 cities and approximately 50 settlements, and some of the settlements only have maybe two people, and some places they have maybe 100 or 200 people. So this is very challenging for us. One of the good things you can say is that we have a joint municipalities, so we only have 4 municipalities, and it makes a change when it comes to getting educated people covering the municipalities. As I said before, being independent, wanting to be more independent is a condition for us, and it's a difficult condition. At the same time, you can say that we've been very inspired by the Nordic welfare system historically, and this is getting under a lot of pressure, because maybe we need to do it in a different way. Maybe we need to do it so it brings out more the kind of society that we would like to have. So these are the things that we're talking about in society and at the political level. A thing for Greenland is that we're a very traditional society. I think some in Iceland, at least a couple of years ago, will know what it's like, and that we have to go to a modern society. So there's a huge gap between the way of living, if you're in a settlement with only a couple of hundred people, or if you're in the capital. It's a very different way of living. So somehow we need to work within these conditions. We have made a strategy for 2015, and I was very inspired by Sweden, who were very doing the same thing as us. And the three areas that we're working on are protection, participation, and development. And this is the way we prioritize them. We need to build a fundament at the first, looking at children who are having problems, social problems, and finding a way to deal with them. So it's at the same time prevention, because what we're talking a lot about in Greenland is early detection, but also early action. And I think these two things are very important. At the same time, we're we need to look at participation, because as some of the other Nordic countries have said, there's a lot of children who doesn't know they have any rights, and it's a challenge for us to come out everywhere and let them know that they have these rights and how they can use them. And the last thing is development. And as I said before, we have a lot of problems at the education systems. There's a lot of children who don't get their exam, and therefore it's difficult for them to go further on onto the education system. Activities, I've pointed out, I think it's very important to in Greenland, because especially in the summertime, children don't have anywhere to go. And the privileged children go outside the city or to other countries. But a lot of children just stay at home and don't have anything to do. And the municipalities are not good enough to provide activities for these children. So this is very important. Yep. Thank you.